is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk radio like you've never heard it before.
Guess what?
It's the Ramble.
Yeah, another 2 hours of fun conversation and bon mot. It's getting along or something. I don't know. Frivolity. Who cares? We go on till midnight and we'll be here until then. So just sit back and enjoy it. You can call us later when we bring on the citizens panel. But, you know, right now it is Wednesday and it's time for a guest.
Hello to Larry Bubbles Brown. Hello, Larry.
Hello, Alex. Time for another uplifting segment.
Yeah, yeah. Which two of the most depressing people in America? You know, nobody's ever thought of doing that in show business, is doing a show in which you can tune in every day and be guaranteed that something depressing is going to be discussed.
Maybe we should do ads for Prozac or Zoloft.
Yeah. I mean, in this day and age, it could probably be something like things that are worse than Trump. You don't take Zoloft, do you?
No. I tried 20 years ago. I tried Prozac, which really messed me up.
But that would ruin your act.
Yeah, it didn't make me happier. It just kind of had some bad side effects. Have you tried any?
Yeah, I was on Zoloft. Do you remember that whole advertisement?
Oh, that's right. Yeah, it gave you diarrhea.
It gave me diarrhea for a few days. The first few days of Zoloft, I got diarrhea, and then it went away. And what it was replaced by was a complete peace of mind, which completely ruined my act. And I took it for about a year, maybe two or something, and my career started going into a decline. And I suddenly decided, finally, when I was out of work in New York and looking for work, I decided to stop it and see if somehow I would become more aggressive. And sure enough, I became more aggressive and I got myself a job. So in a way, those things are great. You know, I mean, I was so rational and everything was crystal clear and blah, 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 blah. But on the other hand, I didn't have the eye of the tiger.
Interesting, yeah. But it did make you happy.
It wasn't a question of happy. It was completely rational. I mean, I remember I had this friend, Paul, and we used to take these drives up to Lake Tahoe. And on the way, I would discuss things with him. And the clarity in those days that I had when I was discussing stuff with him was just amazing to me. All of a sudden, the world suddenly came into focus, all right? But you and I are not in the work of having the world come into focus.
No, I am so unclear, so that does have an appeal to it. I think you get the same effect with meth, too.
I guess. I don't know. But all I'm saying is that if you're a comedian or you're a performer or talk show host like me, and life is, you have all this clarity and you're not depressed about anything, well, geez, you know, that takes away our talent. It takes away the thing that makes a living for us. Our craziness.
Yeah, takes away the funny.
All art is putting your craziness on display.
Okay? Exactly, yeah.
And so I found that those drugs were just terrible. They were just terrible. I mean, they were wonderful, but they were terrible. And
You have sometimes getting off those things can be dangerous. I had, when I got Prozac, I had a road rage incident that was pretty scary.
Really?
Yeah, you're supposed to like wean yourself off those. I think I just stopped taking it, and I think those pills, they repress all your anger and stuff, and then when you get off them, there's been a lot of cases where people either murder somebody or they a lot of suicides. So. Well, you got to be really careful with them.
Yeah, well, I don't know if I ever had the reputation, but I had a temper, you know. I could go into a rage.
I saw you get mad a couple of times.
Yeah.
But I always assumed that was just from I think morning radio, that the sleep pattern be screwed up, makes anybody angry.
Oh, there's also the pressure.
Yeah.
You know, the pressure was, in a lot of ways, unrelenting. I mean, you have several pressures when you're doing a show like that, especially when it's popular, okay? The first pressure you have is you'd like to change stuff, but nobody wants you to change anything because it's working. And my feeling in life is if you don't continue to evolve, then eventually you're going to find yourself in a situation where you're not important anymore.
So to run a show like you had takes so much focus. I couldn't do it, and the pressure is all. I had the easy job just doing a couple of traffic reports, and then I didn't have to do anything. You got to be there for 4 hours and with intense focus, and that's why I never wanted to be. All the comics I came up with, they all wanted their own sitcom. I just wanted to be like the supporting character, because no pressure, you know?
Well, there's no pressure. You're absolutely right. Every month I had to worry about the ratings coming in and everything, and I had a couple of things that were pressures. Number one, one of my biggest pressures was your job. You know,
you're responsible for a lot of people working.
Exactly. We had, I guess, at a certain point, I counted, I think we had something like 9 people working on my show.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
usually.
All of this, and by the way, all of this crept up on me. I didn't realize it. In the beginning, it was just me and my news person, and that was it, right? Then all of a sudden, I've got a producer, and then that producer's got an assistant, and then I've got a traffic guy, and then I've got somebody does traffic, and before you know it, before you know it, I've got like 9 people whose livelihoods I'm responsible for.
So suddenly, you're a small corporation.
Well, not that I'm a small corporation. I'm a small headache or a big headache, and so here. You know, all I want to do is go in and do a goddamn show. And then all of a sudden, like, certain things kind of get away from you because you're not paying attention to it. All you're doing is you care about doing the show, right?
Mm-hmm.
But you don't pay attention to anything else. One morning I'm doing the show, and, you know, we would go to breaks for commercials. And unlike the early days where when we went to commercials, I played them. Now they were being played in another room by somebody else who was hired to be there,
mm-hmm.
right? So I'd go to a break, and I'm sitting there, and I'm sitting there, and I'm sitting there, and I'm sitting there, and I said, that's an awfully long break. They said, no, it's a normal break now. I said, now? I said, how many commercials were in that break? And they went, some of them were a minute, and some of them were 30 seconds, but they totaled to 4 minutes in the break. Which, by the way, by today's standards, is short. And I said, how many commercials are we running an hour? And, I failed to even pay attention to that. And mm-hmm. the person counted them up and said, oh, 21 commercials. I said, that's a third of the hour. And it used to be, and when I first started, it was pretty simple. It was, I think, no more than 12 minutes an hour. And all of a sudden, it's up to, you know, because the show was popular, and so it could make money, and so they put in as many commercials as they possibly could. Well, what was the result of that? All of a sudden, I had noticed that we had had a problem that the ratings were starting to drop. And the reason they were dropping was because there were so many fucking commercials.
It was terrible, yeah.
The show hadn't changed. I was still just as funny. Larry Bubbles Brown traffic reports were still just as funny. But what was causing it? What was causing it were all those fucking commercials. And I went out. What?
They were taking in so much money at the station then. I remember that every morning, it was incredible, I think, how much money they made.
Yeah, yeah. And also... I would walk. I walked into the boss's office when I found that out, and I went, "We got 21 commercials an hour." I said, "That's a bit much." And I said, "On top of that, we got 5-minute newscasts. You know, so when you add the whole thing up, I may as well not even come into work. You know, I could just phone it in." And he said, "Well, we got to make the money." And blah, 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 blah. And I said, "You know, that's way too many commercials." And he said, "Well, live with it." You know.
And
they're not going to give up that money.
Well, they felt, see, what happens is there's always this constant fight, and people don't understand this, I guess, between talent and business. And business owns the shop, okay? They pay your salary. So you got to listen to them. But they don't have the sophistication to know that if you do 21 commercials an hour, you're killing your audience. You're killing your timing on the show. The show loses pace, you know?
All
those things. And while I tried to keep the pace up during the breaks where I just kidded with the comics and we talked and we had a good time, I didn't just disappear. As you may remember, I stayed in that studio for the whole time. But they failed to realize that you can kill the cash cow by trying to cash in on it, you know, never could get anybody to understand that. And so we continued to have 21 commercials an hour. And now today, you want to hear how bad it is today? I was working at WOR about 4 years ago. They had me come in and do some, you know, relief work. And this was a major station in New York at one time. It no longer is, but it was at one time, talk station. And I'm doing the show. My producer is my old producer from Sirius, Albert Reynoso. And so we go and we start doing them. It's time to go to a break. And we go to a break. And I'm sitting there. And I'm sitting there. And I'm sitting there. And I'm sitting there. Wait a minute. Hold on a second. And I'm sitting there. And I finally said to him, how many minutes of commercials are in this break? He said, oh, 7 minutes.
Jesus.
I said, what? He said, yeah, all the breaks, there were 3 breaks in the hour or 4 breaks in the hour, and they were all 7 minutes long. I said, how do you expect anybody to stick with a program? They can go away, find something. I can go home, have lunch, and come back, and the break will be over, you know?
Everyone's tuning out on that. Great.
So they're not tuning out. They're going around the dial testing to see if anything else out there is happening. You know, my idea was, here's what I told my boss at Live 105, I learned this, oddly enough, from the weirdest person you could think of. You remember Walter Keane?
Remember the name.
They made a movie about him recently. He and Margaret Keane were artists.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And they drew the faces with the kids with the big eyes. Which their work wasn't bad. It was all the other stuff that, like the Woolworths knockoffs, you know, where they would have kitties with big eyes and birds with big eyes. But I interviewed him and I went over to his place and they had this. They were doing this. It was like an assembly line. Okay, one night he would do the picture, and she would do some filling in, and the next night. She would do the picture, and he would do the filling in. In other words, it was just back and forth. The two of them, between the two of them, they were this assembly line of kids with big eyes. And his paintings were selling phenomenally. And I said to him, I said, you turn out this much all the time. I said, why do you do that? He said, well, he said, I was in real estate, and this is like real estate. I treat it like real estate. And I said, well, what happens if you're selling too fast, you know, and you can't keep up with the demand? Because you only do one a night. Imagine, you're an artist. If Van Gogh did one a night, his paintings wouldn't be worth shit, you know?
Yeah.
And he said, how we manage to keep up with the pace is when the paintings are selling a lot, we raise the prices, and that slows the sales down, okay, so that we can keep up with the pace and make more money. We don't have to live up to the pace. We adjust to it, and people have to pay for it. So when you're selling more, you charge more, and then that will slow it down so it accommodates you. So I told my boss this once, why don't you just do 12 spots an hour and raise the rates? And because obviously people want them. So if they want them, they want to be part of an exclusive club. And you can also say to them, look, you know, you're not going to be in a cluster of commercials with 20 other people. You know, you're going to have a certain exclusivity on the Alex Bennett program. And he said, oh, we can't do that. Why? Oh, well, because they won't buy because it doesn't meet the market specifications for price on spots and stuff. And I went, that's such bullshit.
Yeah.
You know, just charge more for them. You'll lose a lot of advertisers, but you'll make a lot. You'll make the same amount of money, less commercials, larger audience. They wouldn't listen to me. So, you know, that's
they never do.
That's the trouble with the whole business. It's always been that.
Well, wasn't there a time that before they deregulated that there was a certain number of commercials you could have per hour?
There wasn't actually. I think
that was TV.
It was somewhat dictated by competition. In other words, you didn't want to have too many commercials for exactly the reason I was mentioning, that people would tune it out. And that didn't play well. So it just becomes a real it's a real conundrum, and it's the constant fight you have as a performer against the forces of evil, which would be the guys trying to make the money out of it, you know.
And they always win.
Well, I mean, let's face it, my job is twofold. Number one, my job is to entertain the audience. That has always been my creed. Unlike a lot of other people on radio, I consider myself a performer before being a radio guy. That's why I never hung out with radio guys. I couldn't stand that radio talk. You know, I mean, I think you would agree. I was probably more of an entertainer than I was a radio guy.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
So my first job is to entertain the audience, but my other job is I'm there to make money, and I'm there to keep my bosses happy that they're making that kind of money, and so that's the, you know, that's the crux of it. That's what you got to do. You got this twofold thing where you got to make money for these guys on one side. That's your job. That's why you're paid. That's why you got the job and the money was to make them money. That's all they care about. But they don't care whether you do a good show or not. That doesn't even add into it. If you're doing a shitty show and it's still got ratings and they can charge high prices for it and they can sell out all the commercials on the show, then they're delighted, you know? So yeah. So that's the whole thing that you live with every day trying to do a morning show. And
4 hours.
And go in there and make it fun. Because the idea in doing a show is not to be funny. Again, another lesson learned from somebody I didn't have a lot of respect for, Steve Allen.
Mm-hmm.
But I heard him in an interview once, and he said, the job of the host is not to be funny. He said, you can't be funny all the time. He said, the job of the host is to be fun. And you can be fun all the time. You know, it's much easier than trying to be funny to come up with, you know, 200 jokes a show and make people laugh with the jokes. You can make them laugh by being fun. And he was right. If you look at Steve Allen's whole demeanor on the air, it was the attempt at being fun. And he also said the other thing that I have used all my life as a guiding principle, and that is when you have a guest on, don't try to top the guest. If the guest is really funny, let him be funny. You brought him on the show to do exactly that, and you're going to be there tomorrow. He's not.
I think Johnny Carson realized that too. He never tried to, unlike some talk show hosts always try to top the guest. Carson just let him go.
And if you may remember the way I ran my show, I never tried to top the guest. If the guest was doing the job, okay. If the guest wasn't funny or was dull that morning, and then it was my job to jump in and top the guest, you know, because the guest wasn't doing what I wanted them to do.
And the other job, of course, that you have when you're doing a show like that is you're a ringmaster, you know? And in my case, that could I would walk out of those shows just loopy from all the control I had to exercise in order to make...
Yeah, when you have three comic guys, they're like Pearl and Bob Rubin.
And Warren Thomas, you know, and they're all going at it. And you've somehow got, you know, this is also going out over the radio. And you've got to have this make sense to a radio audience. It's a really difficult hat trick, you know.
And that would be
amazing hat trick, as a matter of fact.
Yeah.
So, you know.
But when it worked, it was so great.
Oh, when that show worked, it was, you know. And I don't think you'll see that like of that show ever again. And people always write me and say, come back to San Francisco, do it again. And I go, you know. You just can't. It wouldn't work today. It wouldn't work today.
It was like getting paid to go to a party, though, when it worked. It was so much fun.
Well, you couldn't do. I couldn't do it today. Like I have this thing here at Gabnet called Citizen Panels. Every night I do a show, and up to 9 other people call, and we all sit around talking. Right. Good idea. Right. Mm-hmm. Not being done on radio anywhere, in spite of the fact that I publicized it and nobody's called me to say, tell me how that works. They weren't even curious so they could steal it, you know, because they're afraid of change, right? And yet this is the first new change in talk radio and talk shows in 40 years. You know, it's not just one person talking to another person. It's a group of people talking with each other. And I think it's very immersive, you know, and yet it's hard to get people interested in it. But I do that, and that's also being the ringmaster as well. And you have to know when to shut up, and you have to know when to jump in. If you got two people arguing like crazy, you don't want to get in the middle of that. You want to let them have at it, you know?
No, the worst radio is people talking over each other.
Yes. And the worst radio, and I think you will agree with this because you've had to do this from time to time, is the morning show host who thinks the idea is being funny, not fun, and when a comedian comes in, does try to top him because they want to look like the top dog. You know, and I never understood that. You brought this guy in. You want him to do essentially his act. And you're going to interrupt him trying to be funnier than him? That, you know, and morning show hosts, there almost isn't a one who isn't that way.
I know.
You know, and I've heard people, comedians I know, talk about, gee, it's not, I got spoiled doing your show, you know, because you let me do what I do. And I never tried to top the guest. I occasionally could be really funny. But I never tried to top the guest. I tried to be maybe part of the group, you know. What I've done is I've just given a master class in how to do a talk show. You know? It's hard to tell people who never heard me in San Francisco what an impact that show had on the public. It's hard for me to tell myself what an impact it had, because when I was doing it, I didn't realize how big it was.
Oh, it's huge, and you know, I tell you to this day, I every time I do a show, somebody comes up and asks me about you and how they miss the show.
Well, you know, now that I've done, you know, I do my nightly show now also on Facebook, which I find gets me a much larger audience, and I'm connecting with those people from San Francisco they probably didn't think I was alive. And by the way, keep listening to me because one day, you know, I'm not going to be here. All right. But they go, oh, yeah, I didn't know you were still around and now I found you and, you know, blah, 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 blah. And of course, they expect the same show, but they're not going to get it.
Right.
I've evolved, you know. But I mean, they all say the same thing. Oh, come back to San Francisco. You got to get on the air here and do that show again. And so on. No, it couldn't be done today. it couldn't be done today because I couldn't have a studio audience because people are worried that bombers will come to the studio or some guy with a gun or whatever. So you would, having a studio audience is a very difficult thing. No radio station would understand that. No radio station has a studio big enough to do it in now. So
yeah,
and the studio audience was important because they let you, the comedian, be honest. You knew when something was funny or not funny.
Oh, and, yeah, that was the greatest part of the show. Genius to have a live audience at a radio show.
Well, the audience egged you on. Hey, listen, we've run out of time here.
It always flies with two depressed guys.
Yeah, well, we weren't depressed today.
We were very upbeat.
I was just consumed with the thing I love most, talking about me.
No.
Hey, you want to do this again next week? Say
you
yes. Please say yes. Please say yes.
Yes. Yeah. You're the only one that'll have me. I have to say yes.
Okay. Well, ladies and gentlemen, Larry.
Here is today's saint. Stories of Christianity's greatest men and women.
Today's saint is Saint Alex, the complaining saint. Saint Alex was born to non-believing parents in the land of Sodom by the Bay, a heathen land. His father, an itinerant musician, entertained the Sodomites during drunken dance orgies and introduced a young Alex to the vices of sex, drink, and drugs. Growing into adulthood, Alex surrounded himself with slackers, perverts, and techno freaks who prized excess and satire of virtue above all and complained loudly about his lot in life. One day, God spoke to Alex using the form of his somewhat befuddled mother, and lo, a miracle conversion took place. Alex of Sodom became Saint Alex of the Marina, winning converts the length and breadth of the land. Let mankind's complaints be my complaints, he would say. Boils, sores, swollen lips afflicted him. Find salvation in God, he would preach, and end each parable with, do I not look thin now that I am saved? Today's saint, Saint Alex, the complaining saint.
This is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk radio like you've never heard it before.
Hi, everybody. How are you? This is Alex, and this is the Ramble. And it goes on, as I say, until midnight. And we're going to turn on our Skype lines now so people can call us, and we can do citizens panels, and we can have all kinds of fun like that. Okay? Okay? All right? All right? Let me just get a few things ready here. I'm doing this thing so that we have both the myself and the citizens panel now on the show, and it creates a certain amount of havoc for me. It just seems I'm getting maybe too old to be that coordinated to get everything to go, or maybe it's just the program I'm using is so small in front of me that it's hard to change. But anyway. And then I have things like the end of the Bubbles interview, it cut off just the very end. And did the same thing last night when I had Rube on, and I don't know why. It makes no sense at all. So I don't know. Anyway, that's those are the things I face here on this fine little program. Anyway, what is that? What? Oh, is that my cup of coffee? Oh, that's what it is. Okay. I was trying to look. Okay, well, we're waiting for people to call. And here's how you call. You use Skype, and you use the ID GabNet Live. That's our phone number, so to speak, GabNet Live. That's our Skype number. And if you don't want to use our Skype number, you can always use a telephone. And using a telephone, it's 347-352-0079. And should you forget any of these things, all right, any of these things, you just go to gabnet.net, and there we are with all the information, all on the page on how you can call the program and how you can be part of it. And also, if you don't want to watch me and watch the citizens panel, you can just watch the listen to the sound alone over there at gabnet.net, where we always have the feed running 24/7 of our program. So do that. Okay, so this is where I just you know, I don't want to start talking about anything on my own, because then people call and then I got to say hello to them and I forget where I was and so on. So I just sit here waiting for people to call. So I'll just pick my nose while we wait for people to call the show. Who knows? You know, I'm just waiting for the night that nobody does, right? And we're going out. I know we're going out everywhere we should be going out, so there's no excuse for people not to call. And at this point, I complain about it, and then about an hour in, I'm hanging up on people because we have more than a full house. And after we get nine people on the line besides me, I have to hang up on people because otherwise, I can take up to 25 people, but that would be just with audio. But the reason I like the video, and I prefer for you to use Skype and call me using video, is exactly that reason. Here comes Brian. He's our first call tonight. Hello, Brian. Hello there, Brian. Hello. How are you?
Hello.
You there? You there? Yeah, I can hear you. Let's see here. Let's add Jeff to the group. Wait a minute. And let me also change over to the camera here so that people can see the citizen panel. Brian is, of course, calling from a mobile phone, so you can't see him. But Jeff is calling from his usual place at home with all those lovely pictures in back of you. We're going to have someday going to have to ask you what those are.
Exactly.
Are they treasured?
It's something that my son put together.
Oh.
And he went to Pratt University?
Yeah.
And he's an architect?
Yep. That's where they, a good school for that. Oh, yeah. And we can see, look at those. See, all the people watching us using Facebook can actually see it. And what are those architectural designs or were those?
That's the actual buildings.
That he did.
We just drew a combination of every one.
Really?
And those are buildings that are in Brooklyn.
Wow. I don't know why we do this thing on TV every night now, because everybody who's calling is on a phone, so you can't see anybody. But it was very nice. I had some friends when I was younger who went to Pratt for exactly that, architecture. It's supposedly one of the best schools in the country.
It is a pretty good one, yeah. And he's very good at it.
And it's here in Manhattan, am I correct?
It's in Brooklyn.
In Brooklyn, okay.
Yeah.
Close enough.
Yeah,
How are you doing tonight, Brian?
I'm doing all right.
Yeah? Where are you currently?
Currently in my vehicle en route from what's called McKees Rocks in and around Pittsburgh to driving to my house. So in about, as usual, as has been the case for the last week or so,
yeah.
About 30 minutes from now, I'll be reconnecting to you through my computer.
Good, because we love seeing you, as the Jews call it, your punim. Hello, Rob. How are you?
Hello.
How are you this evening, Rob?
Doing well. You?
I'm doing okay. And of course, Phil Meyer is joining us as well. Hello, Phil.
Hey, good evening.
We don't see you yet, but
I'll turn the camera on.
I think that would help. You too, Rob. We can't see you either. Well, here Phil's whirling around. Rob's whirling around. They'll all suddenly appear. See that magic? It's like magic. No, what happened to me tonight, just before, it's never been perfect lately because I've got so many elements going now with the video thing that there are certain things that just don't work right. And then at one point last week, I had to completely reinstall the operating system on the PC, so some things don't work like they should. But tonight, what my problem was, I went on and I suddenly found that I had reinstalled Skype. All right, the old version of Skype, so I could do it the easy way. And I forgot to turn off don't automatically upgrade it. So I had to reinstall Skype like 2 minutes before the interview with Bubs was over with. So I'm a little shaky tonight.
This is the best looking Skype I've seen in a long time, the
really?
Way it's laid out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's good. It's good, you know. How was the thing you went to last night, Phil?
You know, it was very interesting. I've never been to a rap concert before.
You at a rap concert? Hold on a second. I want to just close my eyes and imagine this. Okay, go ahead.
I went. David sent me 4 tickets for Tech N9ne. Tech N9ne, I guess he's been around. I read a little bit about him. It's real high energy, but it's basically, I can sum up rap in a couple of seconds. I put my pinky in her asshole.
Wait a minute. Steve, if you're going to talk, mute yourself, okay?
He can't hear.
He can't even hear us.
Put the phone down. Anyway.
Who's just joined? Oh, Tim's just joined us, too. Hi, Tim.
There are things.
Hey, Steve.
Hello.
Steve?
Hey, yeah. I'm sorry. I was just talking to
a nurse. Yeah, well, if you're going to do that, mute yourself, okay? Now let me.
I don't know how yet on this phone. I have to figure it out.
Yeah, so. Well, you know, either that or just cover it with your hand or something. No, don't talk yet. I'm talking to Phil right now.
Okay.
Right. So anyway, you were at this rap concert.
Yeah, I had a nice table overlooking the whole thing without anybody bothering me, and it was nice and reserved. And
yeah,
they do a good job of checking the crowd, making sure they don't have any weapons. And but I tell you, the basic premise of rap is motherfucker this, motherfucker that. Nigga this, nigga that. And I stuck my pinky up her ass.
By the way, it's nigga.
Nigga, yeah.
Yeah, then it's okay. It's okay.
So, you know, and I'm looking at these guys and I'm saying, well, at least they're gainfully employed. And
let me ask you this. Did you feel old?
No, actually, well, they had a lot of
energy. Let me ask you another question. Did you feel very white?
No, I was comfortable. There was a lot of
white guys there.
Really? Yeah. Because if you had said I voted for Trump, you wouldn't have gotten out of the building alive.
Well, why did you go, Phil?
Steve, that's a stupid question to ask. It was free.
Oh, okay. Yeah, all right.
I learned that from Alex. But, you know, the thing was, beyond the fact that it was free, it was nice to experience a different kind of genre that I never would have made an effort to see.
Yeah, you wouldn't have paid anyway. So
I certainly wouldn't have paid. And even
buy all his music?
No, I didn't understand a word he was saying. And I did put some of it out on Periscope yesterday.
While it was on?
Yeah.
That's illegal.
No, a lot of people do that.
Oh, come on.
It's illegal.
Did you count the curse words?
No, but there was more curse words than non-curse words.
I figured.
You know the day I knew I was getting too old for this world? Okay, that I'd finally crossed over, and I was still at Live 105 in San Francisco. So I was, what was I at that time? Probably somewhere in my 50s, I guess, 50, early 50s, maybe late 40s. They bring in, they say, we got this great group or this great music thing, because I always put performers on my show. They would come by and play, you know, and we would have them come by all the time. This guy comes by, and they set up 2 turntables.
Oh yeah, that's
and he starts. Do it. One minute, he starts doing the scratching. And when he's through, I just said to him, I think I said on the air, I said, "What the fuck was that?" I didn't say fuck. I said, "I do that when I'm queuing up records to play on the air." And this guy's doing it, and he was getting like thousands of people to have him show up and have him do that. And I said, I'm sorry, this is the point at which I can, as a person who's getting older, say, I don't understand.
And there was a lot of fingers in the air and fists in the air, and then they start lighting candles or cigarette lighters or whatever. I can see that it appeals to a younger audience. And, you know, just like
you and I differ. I can't see where it appeals to a younger audience. Okay. I when you hear this stuff, Jeff, do you understand it? I mean, no. I understand rap. Well, rap, I get.
I do, but this is a little bit at the point where it's just not interesting for me. And it doesn't have enough sounds other than boom, 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 boom. You know, it's a lot, very repetitive.
The guy, this Tech N9ne guy, he actually had a beautiful voice. And he sung some things that, you know, I didn't understand what he was saying, but it sounded nice. And the I remember as a kid, my parents weren't too happy about
you,
me, of course, but, you know, the music that I was listening to.
Yeah.
And I liked everything from the Iron Butterfly to the Beatles. And, you know, my dad liked Red River Valley. And with all the money he spent on guitar lessons for me, it was the only song he wanted me to play. And actually, it was the only song I knew.
I got to tell you, I think that one of the reasons the Beatles were so popular is your parents could listen to them and not go, "What's that?" Because they were melodic. There were songs, and
they looked like girls.
The harmonies too. You know, they had good harmony.
Yeah, but I mean, that would, you know. But this stuff totally just it not only separates the kids from the adults, okay, in a very blatant manner, but it also separates races, believe it or not, you know.
Well, there seemed to be, you know, even on stage, there was white guys appearing with black guys, and they were doing their things, and then they're pulling their shirt off, and this guy had about 600 pounds on him, and he's walking around the stage, you know, doing one of these numbers, and, you know, pumping his
fists. Luckily, we're doing video now with this show, so they could see you do that motion.
Oh, it's...
probably threw his cop in the crowd.
I'm glad I went. I actually did enjoy it. And
really? I can't believe you liked it.
And then
Why, Tony, do you think he wouldn't like it? I mean,
I just can't see Phil at a rock concert.
I mean, if you're going and you don't go with a chip on your shoulder and say, "I'm not going to enjoy this," you know, otherwise, why go at all?
You know, my question. Why go at all?
I invited a friend of mine.
I just can't see like a Reagan type conservative.
Well, I'll tell you the equivalent in my lifetime, of that kind of thing where you separated the old people from the young people, the Ramones. You know, people would say, and I love the Ramones, and they love me too, oddly enough. You know. But I love the Ramones, and I loved what they did. But I would play it for some people, and they go, "What's that?" You know, it's 2.5-minute song. Somebody going, "Kill, you know, beat on the brat, beat on the brat, beat on the brat with a baseball bat." Oh yeah, and I'm going, "Yes."
It's funny.
That sounds like what I heard last night.
In fact, at the Fillmore one night, I was there when the Ramones were playing, and they dedicated Beat on the Brat to me.
I would have loved it. I would have had to break you on the
game. Did you ever hear, Jeff, do you ever hear the Ramones?
No.
Oh.
The one that I used to like, which is quite, I would say, unusual, most people didn't like it, was Bo Dietl. Do you know who that was?
Bo Dietl. I've heard the name, I bet.
The guy that sang the song, Bo Dietl.
Oh, that's a guy, Bo Dietl, in politics.
Right. Well, no, that's...
He played a guitar, and he had one other guy playing with him.
You're not talking about Bo Diddley.
What's his name, Bo Diddley? Yeah.
I'm Bo Diddley. Of course I know Bo Diddley.
But he only had one song, and that was called Bo Diddley.
He had more than one song.
He had others, but they were all the same.
Pretty famous guy.
Yeah, I mean, he put out many, many, many albums over the years. Yeah. But the thing he was most famous for is he made his own guitars. It was like a square box, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, he made his own guitars. And Bo Diddley, where you can get,
You're right. I guess you have to have an open mind to go to the show. I give him credit for knowing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you don't even.
I didn't know if he told you, and I said, "You tell Alex." I couldn't believe he was at the show.
Wait, how is it you can't believe that Phil would do something like that?
I don't know, because I think like he's a little conservative. Like I can't see that.
He could be a conservative and like rap, you know. Tim,
did Tech N9ne have a Tech N9ne with him?
No, it was. He has a song, something about a hatchet, and he says, "Oh, they wouldn't let me bring my hatchet in the in the place."
He's named after a semi-automatic gun, so that's
right.
A cheap, good rapper name.
Yeah, well, it's the one. The Tech Nine, I think, is the gun they used at 101 California to kill all of those people.
Yeah, you know, I don't understand. You know, the what I don't like is when there was a lot of sexism in the lyrics. You know,
there still is.
And
just the fucker like a bitch. And
but you see, also I got to tell you something, and here's how I excuse it. Okay, and see if this makes any kind of sense at all. All right?
White guilt?
No. I consider rap music to be folk music.
Yeah.
Where folk music used to go, a guy would go from town to town and tell stories with song of things that happened. It didn't happen to him, you know. There's songs about murder, you know, in folk music.
Tom Dooley.
Tom Dooley, good example.
Yeah.
And so I consider rap to be in that same category. Just because the guy says, "Shoot the cops, kill your girlfriend, rape your girlfriend, or whatever," he's telling a story.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but I do think
you
that
know,
in this culture, you got to be a little careful with that because you're giving a sense of permission to some people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was also looking at it from a perspective of how would I shoot that show if I was if I wanted to shoot it.
Well, if you wanted to shoot rap, you shoot him with a gun.
Yeah, really. but it was like five acts that came on before this Tech Nine guy. And, you know, they just did a few things. But I noticed that the guys in the pit would do a few minutes with this one, then they'd leave. Then they'd do a few minutes with the next group, then they'd leave. And it was like they were in and they were out. And I had a friend and his girlfriend with us last night. And I said, you know, I'll go watch the show instead of trying to photograph it, because then I end up leaving Faye by herself and I'm off doing what I want to do.
Yeah. Steve, you were trying to say something, and I immediately interrupted you. What were you wanting?
Oh, that's all right. Yeah, well, back to the Ramones for a second. I won't say who the radio guy is unless you want to know, but somebody I admired and would listen to for many, many years. When the Ramones happened, he was really always on the cutting edge, and he hated it. He said he played something from the Ramones one night, and he took the record off while he was on the air and threw it in the studio and broke it.
Who was
and
that?
He said,
who was that?
Vin Scelsa.
Vin Scelsa did that?
Yes.
Are you sure that's not folklore?
No. He told the story on his show. And he said, what happened, though, listen to this, because, you know, he adopted the Ramones. And what's interesting is he said the next day he thought about it a little more. He had second thoughts and at home listened to the Ramones and immediately fell in love with them and started playing them and brought them onto the show. He said it was just in the beginning, the first that he heard of it. He said he thought this is the most horrible thing I ever heard. He liked them.
Well, I love those guys because Joey, for some reason, really took to me. And one morning I went into Live 105 and he's on the couch. He slept there since 3 o'clock in the morning waiting for me to show up. He wasn't even scheduled to be on the show. And he just liked hanging out with me. And I liked him. I loved him. He was a wonderful person. I mean, troubled,
yeah.
but just so sweet, so decent, you know. Do you know we're talking about Jeff, the Ramones? No? Really?
Wow.
I would think that,
you know. Rock and roll high school, Rockaway, all that. Man, yeah. They were great. They were so much fun.
Well, then I won't play something by them because it would drive you crazy.
They should have a Broadway show.
What? What do you say, Tim?
That would make a good Broadway show.
A Ramones show? Yeah, the Ramones, a tribute kind of show to the Ramones.
Yeah,
they've done it
like ABBA.
Well, no, but they've done it also for, you know, the who do you call it? The Jersey Boys was one of those kind of shows, and they did a Motown show. So yeah, do a Ramones show.
That would be a Mama Mia.
Then I could buy a ticket, take Jeff to see it, and say, here's who I was talking about.
Yeah, wouldn't that be so anti-Ramones to do that?
What? To do what?
A Broadway show kind of thing.
You're probably right.
I don't know if you're, I wonder how they would react to that.
Huh? So, what?
I wonder how they would react if they saw it on like Broadway.
Well, I don't know. I think they're all gone. Are they? All, is every one of them dead?
Even the guy who created the shirts. I think Vega, the guy's name used to do the designs. He passed.
Because I know Joey went first, and then
Garth Suny around Easter.
They all had the last name Ramon, but they weren't all brothers.
Did you guys?
Yeah,
that was Paul McCartney's alias, I heard.
Did you guys mention that? Because I missed yesterday. Jay Giles died yesterday.
Jay Giles died.
You know what happened when I saw that? I went, so what?
Yeah.
Yeah, they were good. Well, they
were good. Name one of their songs, Steve.
Ramma Jamma.
Must have got lost. Then their whole new thing with the freeze frame, centerfold, all that stuff.
Yeah, I just never. For some reason, I just felt they were just another band.
They were good. They were good.
Rob seems to agree with me on that.
Yeah, they were successful in the 80s. They, you know, they reinvented themselves with freeze frame and centerfold. But
So what? Yeah.
Yeah.
So what? So when this thing comes across on my phone, Jay Giles has just died. Like, you know, don't you save that for somebody really important? You know?
Yeah, well, hey.
If it's going to come across on my phone, it's got to be somebody really important, you know.
I actually lost my hearing at a Jay Giles concert.
Did you find it?
No.
Must have got lost.
I left the theater. I got on the tube. I went back to my hotel, and people's mouths were moving, but I couldn't hear a thing. And it was kind of scary. And I didn't realize that, you know, eventually, in 20, 30 minutes later, my hearing returned. But it was just everything was blank, no hearing.
And
it
was to me a cheap trip.
Yeah, I'd be scared, man. I'd pee in my pants if that happened to me.
You know, I was right up in the front. You know, it was one of these concert halls that didn't have seats. And so everybody's standing, and I'm right in front of the speakers, right in front of the stage, and I'm having a great time. And I walk out of the place, people's mouths are moving.
Well, I often wondered how musicians could do that night after night and not lose their hearing. But then I remember what's his name from The Who? Peter Townsend, pretty much is deaf.
So is Phil Collins.
Well,
Phil Collins is the same way. You're playing the drums all the time.
Yep.
Huh. You really have to take care of yourself. You really have to like wear earplugs and things like that, and they probably never did.
They do now. I actually make those earplugs for friends of mine that shoot. I learned how to do it for the police department for shooters and so forth. I send the molds out to. And
What a craft. I didn't know you had craft in you from all that cop stuff.
And so I make them for people. And, and they're professional. I mean, they're worth a couple $100 a pair. I do those, and I can make the ones that musicians use that have vents in them. The vents allow frequencies.
Phil, could you make some for me? That way, when Donald Trump talks, I don't have to hear him anymore.
That's good.
I'm going to amplify the Donald Trump frequency.
Oh, by the way, Rob, I wanted to ask you something. I should write you about this, but I have a spot or two that I want to make. And can you record voice still? Are you still have the...
Not really. Everything is completely dismantled.
Yeah, but wasn't there some way we figured you could do it by...
Yeah, but what would I plug it into? I don't have a computer to plug it into.
Oh, your laptop and the
How about your laptop?
I guess I could do it to this Mac.
Why don't I send you something in the next couple of days? Just see if you can...
It sound like shit, though.
Well, let's see what it sounds like. It might sound okay. I mean, you sound good now.
Yeah, you think, compared to my
Well,
studio?
I mean, come on. You had a full-blown studio with processors and everything.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
By the way, you're going to miss all that Gears, if you aren't already.
Oh, hell, I was just thinking about it. normally I'd be in there. But yeah. It'll be back up in September, October.
Oh, September. Okay, well, I'll try doing it myself. Let me do this. Let me send you some copy, and then send me the best you can do with what you've got, and let me see how it sounds.
Okay.
Is that okay?
Did you put your house on the market yet?
It's sold.
It's sold. So when is it closed? Hey. Days to close.
I'm going to close, looks like May 25th.
How long did it take to sell it?
As the first person that came offered me more than asking.
Wow.
Wow.
And I turned him down initially because I wanted to, we had an open house schedule for, it went on the market Thursday evening, Thursday evening or Friday, these people came to see it and they made an offer right away and it was for more than asking. And what they said was, they made the offer expire at 9 p.m. Saturday night, knowing that on Sunday between 1 and 3, we had an open house schedule. They didn't want me to go to the open house.
Yeah.
So my realtor and I both agreed, look, we've got everything set. Let's do the open house. And so we let the offer expire. And, you know, unfortunately for us, didn't realize, but this is spring break time. And so we got really poor turnout at the open house. We only got about eight groups come look at it. And so Monday night, I said to my realtor, do you think those folks would still be interested? She contacted them and they faxed over the contract and we ratified it Monday. Wow. And so, yeah, it sold within the 12 hours it was on the market. It basically sold. I just had to say yes. And
wow.
What are you going to do between May and September?
So I'm going to move into these executive suite apartments that are pre-furnished. So we're going to be living about 10 minutes from where my new house will be. And so I've got to put everything in storage. And we'll be out of here May 25th. And
you will have Wi-Fi where you are.
Oh, yeah. That's the cool thing about this is that they give you – it's like really cheap. It's only going to cost me like $1,350 or $1,400 a month.
Yeah.
For that, it's all included. That's a one-bedroom apartment with electric and every utility, including cable television and Wi-Fi.
Wi-Fi?
High-speed internet.
Well, so can you
and weekly maid service.
Wait a minute. Can you plug it in or does it have to be Wi-Fi?
That's a good question. I would think it's got to be Wi-Fi only because I'm sure the walls aren't.
Yeah.
I'm sure the walls aren't.
Well, that's a pretty good deal.
It's cheap, and so I gotta get a garage for my Corvette because it has to be garaged because that's the insurance deal I have worked out, and I gotta get these two pods that I gotta get filled that are gonna have all my furniture in it, and it's gonna cost me about $300 a month to store those.
You know, what I did with my motorcycle when I moved is I rented a 5A store, you know, one of those storage facilities that you can drive into.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing.
Yeah.
And it'll be $100 a month for that. Right. And I'll also have some extra space in there if I decide that I have some extra stuff I want to store. But the nice thing about these pods is that they have electric in them. They're climate controlled and I have full access to them anytime I want if I need to get in them. Where when I call the moving companies, they fill up these
they just cram them in there and you can't get
in. They bring these small pallets. They're the standard size pallets.
Yeah.
And they get put into the moving truck. They don't inventory anything. They send them off to their facility. And then if you need something, it costs you a fortune to get it because they have this big machine. It's got to be orchestrated to get you there. They got to take each pallet down till they find what you're looking for because they don't know what's in any pallet.
Wow.
So these pods are a better deal.
Well, you're a better man than I am because one thing I hate doing is moving.
Oh, I despise it, and I'm not. They're going to pack. I'm not doing any of it.
Did you make a decent profit on your house?
Yeah, I made a very nice profit on the house. So it's really helping because the house I bought is less expensive.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so it worked out really nice.
Oh, wow. So you'll wind up
going from a townhouse to a regular single family house.
Yeah. Wow.
Half the taxes.
Well, remember me in your will, okay? Anyway.
Yeah, sure. Like I have, like I'm going to.
Although
have
I got to tell you, I got to tell you,
very optimistic, Alex.
You know, girlfriend, a couple of years ago, her apartment house went condo, so she said, "Okay, I'll buy in." So she bought in, and I think she owes about maybe I don't know somewhere like $40,000 now left on it. You know, and somebody upstairs from her. Same exact apartment, type, space and size and everything, sold theirs and got $450,000 for it.
Nice.
Wow.
So yeah. She, as she put it, that's the smartest thing she's ever done in her life. She says her whole life has been nothing but one financial mistake after another, but this one was a good one. And I'm going, yeah, and I'm married to you. you know. He'll take care of me. Yeah. Hi, Brian. We can actually see Brian. Wave at everybody, Brian, so they can know which one is Brian.
I'm here.
Let me bring up a few things. You're what?
You're one away from a full house.
One away from a full house. So somebody else call, and then we will be just fine. Anyway, let me bring up a few things today. I've had this policy where I wasn't going to look at the news. Any newscast, whether it was on network or whether it was, you know, like CNN or MSNBC on cable. And I still really haven't, but I tried. The other day, there was Trump with Gorsuch, where he was being sworn in publicly. There was a private swearing and then there was a public swearing. I don't get that. I think you only have to be sworn in once. Trump was giving a speech, and it was driving me nuts. Not what he was saying, how he was doing it. This man's inability to use a teleprompter is beyond anything I've ever seen in my life.
He's pretty bad at reading. Yeah,
I could only take it for about 5 minutes, so I turned it off. It was, you know, I've decided that events like that I'll watch. I just don't want to watch pundits telling me how to interpret the news. So today, they broke in, oddly enough, Fox broke in on the local Fox station, not Fox News Network, but Fox station for his meet and greet with the head of NATO. My question is, why do you break in for that? You've got a fucking news network. If people want to see it, they can go over there. I want to watch TMZ.
Who's the head of NATO now?
I don't know. I can't remember his name.
Well, actually, it's interesting you say that, because on a semi-related note, I've been thinking the same thing about Sunday nights on Fox. If I want to, this was before when I watched TV. Now I just go on my computer. But they would always cover a baseball game or a sporting event. And, well, you have the MLB network. You have an NFL channel. Show it on there.
Fox even has their own. Well, Fox has their own sports channel. I get pissed off when I want to watch 60 Minutes and they don't adjust enough for time. So that I'm sitting there watching the end of a football game or the end of a golf match or whatever. Last week, the golf match was over, and then they were giving out the green jacket and they were doing that whole thing, and they didn't get 60 minutes on that was scheduled for 7 o'clock till 8 o'clock. So you know this is going to happen.
I got a tip for you.
Why don't you just say 8 o'clock, 60 minutes? All right, the rest of you guys can vamp with your golfing. For a while.
Put your balls and go fuck.
What'd you say, Steve?
No, I was going to say I have a tip for you, because really, you know, yeah, it's good to watch and all. I like 60 Minutes too, but you don't really have to watch it. You could listen. So when it's not on time with all that sports nonsense that holds everything up, go to one of the CBS radio stations online or on the radio and just listen.
I don't want to listen to 60 Minutes on the radio. I want to see it on TV.
I want to see
terrorists. Okay, I don't want to hear them.
if you want to hear terrorists, you just tune into GabNet. You got
another one of your pithy how bad GabNet is jokes. But anyway, getting back to what I was saying about Trump,
they should just make the
So today he was there with this, you know, with the guy from NATO, and all of a sudden, you remember Trump during the election, how much he hated NATO, that we're going to pull out of NATO as soon as I'm president. He's sitting there saying how wonderful NATO is.
We're not going to have anything to do with Syria either.
But I'm saying is that he was so adamant that NATO was something we were going to get out of, and we weren't going to have any part of it.
Yep.
And today he's in with this guy, and he goes, "What a wonderful job NATO is now doing."
Well, I'm glad that Trump is malleable enough to see
malleable. He's a fucking liar. You can't trust a word that comes out of his mouth.
He's
a duplicitous fuck.
Hey, Phil.
Thank you.
Hey, Phil. The question from Tim. Mm, yeah. What about his other backflip today?
He did a backflip.
Where he says the China monetary policy is, it's really okay. They're not manipulating their currency.
Oh, really?
That's a pile of crap.
Do you think that maybe he's learned a little bit that he didn't know as a candidate?
No.
No.
President
no. No. He doesn't have
I think he's a duplicitous fuck.
Yeah, well, he doesn't have the ability to concentrate long enough to change his ideas on anything, because he doesn't have an idea about anything.
He doesn't have enough time.
To change your mind, you have to have a mind to begin with.
He's a transactionalist. He knows he's got more business opportunities in China than he does Russia, so now China's going to be his friend.
Right now he needs China.
And we need him for the North Korea thing, too.
Yeah.
And by the way, the Chinese, the head of China, I'm trying to remember his name now. Something like that. It sounds like a cat being killed, whatever the name is. He really has a very benevolent look about him, but I am told he's an absolute terror. He won't take shit from anybody. Including Donald Trump, but he'll smile a lot. He looks really nice. Did you see him, Jeff, on TV, the Chinese president?
No, I did not.
Yeah, he has a really sweet, nice look about him.
You may try to poison Trump.
What?
He likes to go for a
date. Trump at lunch. Send down.
But well, no, that's
I want to know if he finished eating the chocolate cake today. He sat down with Trump.
This is
fair. What were you saying?
You heard about the chocolate cake incident, didn't you?
No.
Oh.
Oh, he gave a description, and I'll put it on Facebook. A description that it was the most beautiful chocolate cake you ever ate. He was having it with the guy from China, but he had to tell the guy from China. He just told him to go ahead and send the missiles because he didn't want the China finding out half hour later on CNN. And he was just describing a cake. But then he said, I think this was a Fox News interview, he said, yeah, we sent those missiles over to Iraq. He didn't even know what country he sent the missiles to.
I love that. He doesn't know where he sent
them. Did Zhao Ping
snap upside down?
That's what he said? I doubt it.
He might be.
Watch the video.
This video of him telling him this secret information a half hour before or just right after.
It's a video of Trump explaining what happened, the timeline, and that he did tell China while they were eating this beautiful piece of chocolate cake. It's his description. It's not a videotape. It's this tape of him describing what happened that night.
He's probably having fudge in the well.
Well, you know, when you weigh all the things that are going on, I think maybe right now you can put currency manipulation on the back burner.
Yeah,
and
but you don't say you sent missiles to Iraq when it was Syria. And if you're going to decide to have a mission, why don't you go to the war room and call off the damn golf game? He should have been at the White House.
By the way, his name is Jinping, I think.
Yeah,
is that right?
Something like that. Yeah, I can't remember.
It's spelled, I think, XI, but I don't.
Yeah, no, G.
It's a Roman numeral.
Yeah, yeah, it's a Roman numeral.
It's 11.
Hey, how you doing, 11?
And his last name
probably
is
one of them rapper gangs.
Bet everybody in your family's got the same name, probably.
But anyway, what I was saying about Trump was, and he's reading, and he doesn't know how to read from teleprompters without looking like he's reading from teleprompters. And undoubtedly, some people have said to him, look, when you go off script, you could start a world war. Okay, so don't go off script. So he's reading this thing almost word for word, but every now and then, to seem like he's not reading and he's not fooling anybody, he'll go like, we need to have more missiles. What would he do in that case? We need to have more missiles. Yes, more missiles. You know, he'll do that to make it seem like he's not reading it. But he will, and I say, and we're very happy that you're here. Very happy.
Very, very happy.
Yeah, Jeff?
I remember before he became president, he started talking about Japan.
Mm-hmm.
And he was really talking about China. But he kept saying Japan. And he had to
I don't remember that.
Was absolutely the wrong country. There's two countries that you ought to mistake. I guess.
What a debacle! Oh my God.
Well, no, I mean, this thing is getting this thing is highly. We could think of it as highly entertaining, but it's exhausting.
It's exhausting. You're right.
You know.
It's exhausting.
And you know, the Japanese and Chinese say that we that white people all look alike. We say the same thing about them. You know, he made an honest mistake.
Well, maybe you say it, Phil. I don't know.
Over and over and over.
No, but once you live in California and you meet so many different people of Asian descent, you can really discern the differences between a Korean and a Japanese and a Chinese.
Yeah, if you're around them
but
more. Yeah.
If you're, you know, from the Midwest somewhere and the only Chinese person that you've seen is on the can of Chongqing noodles, you know, it's really tough to discern the difference. And, you know,
Well, all I'm saying is I've tried to get back to maybe watching a modicum of news, and I find it unbearable. I can't stand to watch the man, and I can't stand to watch him try and read these things.
And I can't stand to watch him, and I can't stand to hear him. I'm getting so sick of him.
What was that WWF wrestler that says, to watch the man is to beat a man?
Brian, what did you say?
I was just going to say, first of all, what Phil was just saying there, I'm wondering if it was Macho Man Randy Savage.
Yeah.
He died in 08, by the way. But anyway, I was saying the way I get my news now is to two primary, so maybe two and a half, three primary sources. One,
how do you
Google
do two
News.
And a half sources?
Yep.
Anyway, go ahead.
One, Google News, mm-hmm. which is a pool of different resources and different outlets in and of itself. Two, YouTube. And three, C-SPAN.
Well, I think C-SPAN is a good idea. Anything that's literal, in other words, let's say there's a press conference with Sean Spicer. You can watch that and not be corrupted because it's literal. He's saying those things.
Yeah,
people are asking
rare,
questions.
Yeah.
But what the bad part about these cable outlets is that when they start talking, when they start doing all the pundancy, and when that whole thing goes on, and then it just drives me crazy because that's like, where the misinformation comes from.
I don't like the pundancy either, but I do like being able to see certain stories that I wouldn't necessarily see on some networks and vice versa. So
that on the internet.
Well, I can't believe anything that's on the internet. You know,
you can believe everything that's on Fox News?
Not necessarily, but I believe, for instance, the Washington Times more than I believe Fox News. And
Washington Post, you mean?
No, Times.
Washington Times is the worst newspaper in America, Phil.
Well, it gives me stories that...
It tells you what you want to hear. It tells you what you want to hear. And that... that adds to your illiteracy.
I saw the Drudge report, Phil. You don't read Drudge?
There's a problem with Drudge. Drudge is so monetized that if you click on something, within 3 seconds, it wants you to sign up for a service, or you have to go through 27 different pages of something watching ads.
Which one's this?
Drudge.
Drudge? I didn't find that was a case of drudge.
There are a number of sites like that, in all due
fairness. I don't have that problem. My pop-ups are turned off. I don't know. Maybe that's part of it.
Ad blocker works.
Well, what happens is, let's say I click on a news story on Drudge,
mm-hmm.
and it happens to be a New York Times news story.
Mm-hmm.
Then
mm-hmm.
I'll get a pop-up.
Well, the pop-up's from the New York Times. It's not from Drudge.
Right. Well, because Drudge takes you to this New York Times.
Well, yeah, but you can't blame. I don't want to defend Drudge. In fact, he should fall under a dump truck and die drinking gasoline.
That's so where Alex Jones gets most of his internet traffic is from Drudge.
But the fact is that I will defend him in that I don't think that he had a lot of pop-ups. His pop-ups are basically ads that are at the top of the page or at one point in the page.
But when
he sends you to somewhere else, it's that page that is just littered with ads. You know,
well, it's almost every article that I select to read on Drudge, I get bombarded with, you got to sign up. So, for instance, the New York Times, because I've read more than 7 or 9 articles, now the only way I can see the rest of the article other than the clickbait mm-hmm. is to sign up for their online version. And I don't know if it's free or not. I just say no.
No, the online version costs you money. I pay for it. So. In fact, what I did...
Yeah.
Just copy the title of the article, plug it into Google, and you'll find several other outlets covering the same information that won't make it go to New York Times.
I'm a little too lazy.
I don't even have Drudge on my browser any longer. Or Raw Story. I don't have either of them because I consider them both evil, you know.
Yeah, they're bad.
But
you can't access any newspaper in the world off of Drudge. And I suggest you go a different.
Well, somebody last night brought up the fact that there's this supposedly quote new news about the PSA test, which isn't. I don't know why they considered that new, because I read articles that were from 2012 that stated exactly what they suddenly decided yesterday about it. But anyway, I went online. I wanted to find that story. I just simply plugged that in, and it gave me, under news, 10 different versions of that same story, any one of which I could have gone to, and only one of which was the New York Times.
Well, those those health things just get recycled all the time. I mean, they have to do that because for a couple months they'll.
Well, here's what you have to do if you're ever looking up anything on health, and we're all stupid to do it on the internet. is if you see something that makes you feel better, look at when it was written, because they always have a time, and then when you find out it was like 1998 and it's medicine, everything has to have changed in that time.
And then it comes around 3 months later, and what they tell you once, then the next time they tell you it's the opposite.
These new findings
new
findings that everybody was talking about last night, I went and looked up, and it was the same findings that I found that Sloan Kettering had come out with in 2012. They came to that decision back in 2012 that the PSA test had real problems. So,
Well, then the other thing about Drudge is after you get through finally reading an article, then there's this other stuff down at the bottom, like 29 celebrities that died miserable
deaths.
Those,
I always click on those. I don't know why, but I click on those.
It's like a moth to a flame.
Oh, yeah,
and
yeah.
Then you got to go through 300 ads, next, but you can't just find the next page. You have to look around and go down below.
It's like 25 starlets vomiting. And
one starlet that you want to see
vomit.
You can't find it. You go through like.
You have to go to the very end. She's number one.
It's the one that's on the cover. It's the snapshot. Right. The one you want to see. It's not there. Clickbaiting. Duplicitous.
But all of those
Machiavelli-minded motherfuckers that they are.
All of those are. Every time people click them, they make money off the click.
Yeah.
They're
making a fortune on
They were talking about this on 60 Minutes with the way that some of these political people create these things that you then go to see, and they get paid every time you look at them right?
How about the ones?
But YouTube, YouTube's a good. YouTube is a perfect idea. If I could get a couple hundred thousand YouTube people every night, I'd be making money off this show.
Yeah, do you know that YouTube's changing their monetary deal? That in order to start getting money, I think you have to have 10,000 views.
Yeah, I think
to start.
I think to start it was pretty high at 1.2. I don't think it was. I think maybe it was. Maybe it's lower than I heard. I heard like 100,000 it started at.
Well, no, this is to be in the club that gets money,
but
so you can't sign up. That you want remuneration unless you've got something with 10,000
views. But there's like this girl, you know, with her makeup hints or whatever, who got, are you ready, folks, for this, 100 million hits. How much money does she have?
That's hundreds of thousands of dollars, I would think.
Yeah. You still awake, Rob?
Yeah, just listening and just
came just look across. So. What?
Came across a headline that says here the U.S. dollar drops sharply after Trump calls it too strong.
Jesus. So did United Airlines.
Now, let's talk, that's a story we didn't talk about last night.
Yeah.
And that story is everywhere. Yeah. Nobody likes it better than to see video. You know, when there's video of it, then it really becomes a big story. If they didn't have video, this guy being dragged out of an airplane because they needed the seat.
Yeah. Bloody.
You know.
A doctor so that they could fill in those seats with, aspiring peanut servers.
Yes. Well,
doctor who needed to get responsible to do that.
In 2020 hindsight, it would have been easier for them to book with another airline to get those employees over to Louisville, and
all I'm saying is this is the worst possible scenario for disaster for a company like United. I mean, I can't think of anything more disastrous, because I see that person being dragged out like he was. They literally lifted him over the chair. They could have lifted the arm of the chair, but
they sat on their headrest.
They could have moved the headrest. Anyway, they drag him out of this plane. You see this thing of this guy being dragged out of the plane. Do you think you're ever going to fly United again? I'm not going to.
I've got air miles with United, and I'm saying to myself, do I really want to use them?
You know something?
I have no choice. I have no choice. It's one of the few airlines that flies to certain places that I need to go.
Oh, you know something?
Oh, yeah.
I have like 200,000 air miles with United.
Wow.
I have to go United.
You know what they could do? They merged with or bought Continental. Yeah. They could just change the name to Continental. You know, we're now Continental, and we're the friendlier airline.
You remember
where they could fire their CEO.
You know what they're saying was over at United.
Fly the friendly
skies.
All right, yeah.
Well, they didn't get into the air, so I guess that's fair. They never got into the air, so it wasn't the friendly skies yet. Very, very unfriendly ground.
However, if they were up in the friendly skies, they could throw him out into the friendly skies.
All the people on that plane were forced to wait 2 hours while they did what they had to do. And then when the employees actually got onto the plane, the other passengers weren't very happy with them.
I can imagine, yeah.
Well, I mean, this whole process that they've had, supposedly this happened because they oversold the flight.
Right.
And they let the people on. You see, once you get on the flight, you're on.
Yeah.
I also
feel that if I buy a ticket, I've got a seat.
It's in the contract. Yes. In the contract. And the reason why they had to pull a bunch of people off was because they needed to fly a crew to get on another plane and fly, or that plane would have had it been canceled. And so that's one of the big reasons why they do that, is if there's a crew that needs to go where you're going and they need to get there to work, they have to bump people off the flights. And it's in your contract, if you read it, it says we have the right to bump you from this flight. And they usually just ask people, and most people accept either a gift card or some sort of compensation. But this particular flight, nobody did, and
everybody has a price, right, Alex?
That's true. Everybody does.
Just
have a price.
Haggling over price. A briefcase full of cash. People react to cash. They get the cash handout. They keep going until they get somebody that takes. They might get up to $3,000.
No, FAA has a limit. I believe it's $1,300
or $1,350.
$1,300?
Yeah. They had promised FAA they weren't going to overbook any flights.
No, that's not true.
They will all overbook.
And they will continue to overbook.
Did this guy get his money back for what he paid for his luggage being sent?
Imagine he lost his luggage. That'd be funny.
My heart surgeon didn't overbook.
Yeah.
That'd be bad, wouldn't it?
Yeah. What were you going to say, Phil?
We were only going to Louisville. It wasn't a long flight. But what happens when a crew times out, they only have so many hours that they can before they have to be on the plane. And if they're not within that time period, then they can't fly.
Here's my feeling. That's the airline's problem, not mine. I bought a ticket. I have to get to Louisville. Now get me there.
Yeah, but there's another plane that was in Louisville.
I don't give a shit. If you've got that kind of problem, then it's your problem because you created it.
And, the other thing is, and I'm not coming out in defense of United, but on an airline, you've got a pilot, and the pilot can say, you're on, you're off, and he doesn't have to have a reason because he's the pilot and the captain. And
you're such an authoritarian. That's a real cop mentality. Well, if the pilot says you got to get off, you got to get off.
Unless that pilot owns the plane that he's flying in and has his own business, I could see a point there, but he's flying a company plane.
I saw a flight attendant, a male flight attendant, that had an earring in his ear. And the pilot looked at him and said, take the earring out. And no, I don't want to do it. And the pilot said to the
flight attendant, I read that story.
Get off the plane.
Yeah, but the pilot got in trouble for that.
No. This one, he didn't get in trouble.
I think I remember that story, and the pilot did, in retrospect, got into trouble.
I saw it happen.
Oh, this was another story I heard of that happening.
Yeah, I saw it happen. It was right in front of me. And, the guy wasn't happy, but he got off the plane. Because the pilot has the absolute authority to decide if he wants somebody on the plane or not. That's why
I had this. I had this situation where I was supposed to go to New York. I was flying to New York. It wasn't on business. I was just going to New York. Yeah. And this was when the airlines were having all kinds of problems with their scheduling and everything, and planes taking off late. This was a bad time for the airlines. So I get out to the airport. And all of a sudden, they announce the plane is being, held up. And so we sit around, hour passes, 2 hours pass. They don't say anything. So finally, I'm starting to get agitated, and so are a couple of other people, and we're starting to yell and scream. We want to talk to management. Right. Nothing. Now it's 3 hours, and the plane hasn't taken off. And this was the day where I think they were actually booking planes that weren't going to take off, but they were going to put you on one later that was. A couple other people started protesting. There was this one woman, and she and I were the most verbose, okay? I was yelling at them. She was yelling at them. We want to talk to management. They finally brought management in. She and I started going after him, yelling, screaming, kicking, biting, doing whatever you have to do to, how can you do this to us? I mean, it's 3 hours for crying out loud. And finally they said, well, the plane is going to take off in about a half hour. I said, okay, fine. And you just better be good. I said, what do you mean we got to be good? No, we're going to keep complaining until we get on the airplane and blah, blah, blah. Finally, we go onto the plane and they say, we're going to put you someplace where we can keep an eye on you. Oh. Me and this other woman. And they put us in first class. And I go, is this my time out? You know, can I have some more champagne, please? I thought that was the most idiotic thing I ever saw in my life. And now the kicker of this whole story is I get to New York and I get on the phone to somebody and they go, what's her name? What's the name of the actress now? She was a famous actress at the time, and then she hasn't made movies in years. But they said, are you dating so-and-so? And I said, well, it's in Herb Cain's column today in the Chronicle that you were seen at the airport protesting with your what appeared to be your date, so-and-so. And she was a famous movie star. I'm trying to remember her name now. She was in Officer and a Gentleman, Gentleman and Officer. Winger? Deborah Winger. That's who it was. And they said, are you going out with Deborah Winger? Because all San Francisco is talking about is that you're going out with Deborah Winger. I said, where did they come up with Deborah Winger? What that was all about? And said, well, supposedly you and she were at the airport and you were protesting. I said, that was Deborah Winger? I didn't know it was Deborah Winger.
Wasn't she your type?
No.
No, brunette, little
No, she wasn't Zoftig.
Hey, the movies put a few pounds on you.
Somehow I did, not one second did I think it was Deborah Winger. I guess because maybe she wasn't in my wheelhouse. I wasn't a big fan, you know. Yeah, I suppose if it were Linda Blair, I'd be jerking off in front of her, but, you know.
I mean, the head spinning up the
airplane. Yeah. Well, I finally, after years, I got to date Linda Blair once.
Really?
We went out on a date together, yeah. Yeah.
Linda Blair,
because she got to like me as a person, and she said, "Come on, I got to do this show or something. Be my date." So,
yeah, she looks better as an older than she looked as a youth.
Oh well, I had her on the show a couple of times here in New York on Sirius, and if I wasn't going with somebody, I could have dated her. I could have gone out with her, but I couldn't do that, you know. I was going with Marjorie and she'd kill me. So, you know, I'm living with a dangerous woman, you know. Jeez, I the only woman I would never screw around on because she'd kill me. She would.
Yeah, well, Linda Blair would spin that head around, a little bit of green vodka.
I'm sure Linda is sick and tired of that kind of joke.
She was watching The Omen the other night.
Huh?
My mother, she was saying that, and The Omen was on the other night, too.
Really?
Yeah, she was watching Scary.
Do you know a former Doctor Who was in The Omen?
Was he?
Yeah, the guy who gets the priest who gets killed by the thing coming down off the top of the church.
That big thing.
Yeah, that was. I'm trying to remember. Trouton, I think, was his name. I'm trying to remember his name. Yeah, he was like the second Doctor Who.
Oh. Wow.
Yeah, so that's what it comes to. That's what it comes to. So
I always remember him as the guy who says, "How does he say it? I've seen its mother." You mean my wife, Gregory Peck. Yeah. I'm assuming that's the version we're talking about here.
Yeah.
Because they did remake it in 2006. It wasn't bad, but it was just shot for shot remake.
Sometimes you wonder why they remake movies. I can't name very many remakes that have been better than the original. But somehow they think, I guess, that the younger audience won't go see the old, won't look at the old version. They got to look at the new version. I was always bothered by Cape Fear, the Scorsese version, because the original was so good.
Yeah, it was.
You know? But I just don't know why they decide that, it's time to remake movies. I'll tell you what was good, though, I went to see, and I thought I'd hate it, because I love the animated version. Beauty and the Beast is actually a very good picture.
I've heard good things about it.
Very good picture.
Cape Fear is one scary movie.
The original.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, who was in the last one? Was that De Niro or Pacino?
De Niro.
De Niro. Yeah.
De Niro. That was pretty scary.
He played the part Robert Mitchum played in the original. They used both Robert Mitchum and who was the other guy in the original? Was it Gregory Peck? No.
I think it was Gregory.
It was Gregory Peck. They used both of them. Used both of them in this Cape Fear in lesser roles. It's kind of an homage to the original. But I think
they were both very good.
Well, they were both really good. But if I let's say I had to save one for my library because everything else was going to burn up, I'd want to keep the old one.
Yeah.
You know, if I had to make a choice. I see why Mark Scorsese wanted to remake it. It's a damn good story, you know. And but the original was scary as shit too. So, but I don't know. They keep remaking films, and you go, why did they do this? You know, the original was so much better. Like the original Chips was better than the remake. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but I like the cameo in the ambulance.
I'm joking. They should never. They should never have made Chips in the first place.
Oh, Punch needed a job. You know, now selling land, I think.
So what else is happening in the news, Tim, that we should know about? Because you're the guy who's just, you're like an addict.
I don't have the time to read The Fall of the Roman Empire.
Yeah.
So I kind of watch the movie as it's being made on the news. Did you hear about Manafort?
What about Manafort now?
Okay.
See, because you are the guys that give me the news.
Yeah. The day after he resigned, he accepted a bunch of money from people connected to Trump to the tune of millions of dollars, which means...
Why did he take millions of dollars from people associated with Trump? Did they want him to keep his mouth...
It's hush money. It's obviously hush money. And so it proves that he and Bill O'Reilly both settle when it's in their best interest. They both settle. So he settled just like O'Reilly did, and he was beating up O'Reilly. I wouldn't settle. I'd get my attorneys. So Manafort got paid off. Plus, remember they found those ledgers over in the Ukraine that it implied that a bunch of money was given to Manafort's corporation?
I guess. I'll take
some
your...
of those entries.
Yeah.
He was working for the Ukrainian candidate.
But this was part of a corruption. I'm not talking about the legal ones. I'm talking about the part of the corruption money laundering deal, and then I think I got to look this up, but I think he finally registered as a foreign agent, as an agent of a foreign country.
Wow!
And I think that was just the last day or so. So he gets, and then Carter Page, you know, we found that out about him was the reason.
Let me ask you this though, Tim, you know, with all this and all the stuff you say that you've got and this information and that information. Do you think any of it's going to make any difference? I mean, the guy's going to be president for the next 4 years.
Well, they do have the lawsuits pending. I think the conflict of interest.
Jeff has his hand up. Do you think, Jeff, that any of this is going to stick?
Yes, I do. But I think my biggest concern personally, is how is this going to affect the stock market? And because obviously I'm living off of
you're living off
my investments.
Yeah.
And you know, I mean, Trump is kind of a wild guy. You never know what the heck he's going to say. And
he said something foolish about our currency, and it dropped precipitously at 4 p.m. today.
How much did it drop?
Yep. It dropped,
Facebook for the video. It dropped. Where's I'm not on the page anymore.
Below 109 or something.
Yeah. Money.
And I went right to NASDAQ. I wanted to get a decent source on that one.
Yeah, because I know that I'm in a Vanguard account that was doing pretty well, but I've lost about, I don't know, I've lost quite a bit in the last couple of weeks.
Facebook, you can look at the chart, it goes off the chart.
It dropped 0.7%. Major move after Trump told the Wall Street Journal that the dollar is getting too strong.
Well, he helped it not be strong.
I think our dollar is getting too strong, and partially that's my fault because people have confidence in me.
I heard that.
Oh my God.
Talk about your Freudian slip.
God.
You know, the one place that I would trust Trump, and if I were going to trust him with anything, on matters of money, mainly because he, that's the education he was given. He went to, where was it?
He went to Wharton, right?
Wharton. And, you know, that's a good financial education at Wharton. And you would just, I would like to believe that I could say, well, at least monetarily, he can probably come up with some pretty good ideas. But he must, somebody must have, like, taken the test for him to get him to pass at Wharton, you know? Yes, Phil.
The statement on the money being too strong, I agree with him because if the dollar is too strong, then what happens is when you can't sell your products and services overseas, and we want to be able to export our products and services rather than continually import. And
it looks like Phil is reading from a teleprompter, doesn't it?
No, if you have a very strong dollar, and, you know, I did some import-export back in the 70s with furniture from Italy and things like that. And, you know, so I understand that market and what happens, you know, when you're buying stuff from a foreign country or another currency that and you have a stronger dollar, then you can buy a lot of their stuff. And people
you're
do.
You're missing the point, though. The point is that the man has no governor and doesn't think before he speaks, and the things that he says can cause major problems in the world.
Let me put it this way. When he wasn't president and he said these kind of things on Entertainment Tonight, okay, it didn't fucking matter.
Right.
When you're president, anything that comes out of your mouth has consequences. So you have to be careful. And but even something as simple as that, or as what he would think is simple.
But a weakening dollar is a good thing for American companies.
But you don't understand, there's a bigger picture to this.
All right, before you say that, Rob, keep that thought. You're saying it's good for American companies. Is it good for the American people?
Sure, as long as they're not interested in buying stuff from China. And
I'm very interested in buying stuff from China. Anyway, Rob, what were you going to say?
My point is that, again, there's a bigger picture here. The bigger picture is the man needs to control what he says. He may think things. It doesn't mean you say them. You don't. It's not verbal diarrhea. You just don't blurt out everything that's coming.
True. Yeah.
You got. You're the president. You need to be presidential.
Unless you want the dollar to fall.
It should come from a lower level staff person, not from him.
Maybe. Yeah. If that's what you want.
Yeah. If you want to get that message across, let it come from a lower level as president.
Most people don't trust Trump anyway.
I think it comes from American manufacturers that want to export their products but can't because the dollar is too strong.
What products do we make here?
Well, we make automobiles.
Are we the world leader in automobiles?
Not anymore, but
I don't think we export our automobiles. I know that in Asian countries,
we make them there.
We make them there. We're not exporting.
Yeah, but the ones that we make here, we could export.
We don't export them. You just heard Rob. He's absolutely right. We make Chevy makes Chevys in China.
Yeah. Well, the only way we're gonna, I understand that. It's just that the products that we do make here, and there are numerous products, we make carpet. You know, carpet is an American-made product. And a lot more could be sold overseas.
Nobody wants carpet overseas.
Isn't so strong.
Well, nobody uses carpet over, like in Asia, nobody uses carpet. Everybody uses tile.
Well, right now, because tile is cheap. And
I'm trying to think, when I stayed in a place in China, did we have carpet?
I can't remember seeing carpet in Asia. I've been in Singapore, I've been in the Philippines.
Yeah, I think where I was staying in China, the place I was staying in had carpet in it.
Maybe hotels.
People always want what they can't have. For instance, in the 50s, nobody wanted hardwood floors. They all wanted carpet. And the pendulum swung the other way. Now people want hardwood floors and they don't want carpet. But in other countries, they haven't had it. So they would want it if they could afford it.
Well, hardwood floors can kill you these days.
I was thinking about you, Phil, because I went with all hardwoods on the main level of my new house.
Nice.
We're gonna have carpet in the bedrooms and in the basement, but
Yeah, that's hardwood. Good. I think you'll like it.
You say you're buying, you're literally building a house rather than buying one.
Right.
And you say that it's cheaper than the house to build it than you're, the one you're living in and bought. Okay.
That's right.
Is it cheaper to build a house than to buy one?
Not usually.
Because it's about the same price, but so for example, when I built this place back in 2009.
Mm-hmm. You built the one you're in too.
Yeah, yeah. I built the one I'm in too. And when you build it, it's not easy for other people to sell their homes while there's a lot of building going on.
Mm-hmm.
Because what are you going to, you know, would you rather buy new or buy someone's used if the prices are that different, right? So here they finish building. When they finish building, the prices really start to climb. Now the place I'm moving to, there's a lot of building going on. It's a much newer community, and there's a ton of build. They sold two houses in my development. The sales lady who I bought my house from last week sold two houses. That's a lot of, you know, that's in fact, when I bought my house at the very end of March, they held it until April because mm-hmm. they already met their quota for March.
Yeah.
And they were worried with the holidays and such, they weren't going to make their quota for April.
Mm-hmm.
So they actually held my house and reported it in April just so that they, you know, knew that they were. But they're selling houses like crazy. And it's I figure by the time I go sell my house, it'll be worth $100,000 more than I paid for it.
Yeah.
You're going to have to buy run flat tires to live there because, you know, when they're building houses, there's nails all over the place.
Yeah. I didn't really run into that here. They do a pretty good job. I didn't have that problem here. What you do have is a lot of dust for a while.
Yeah.
You know, I just was at we went to visit the site where our house is going to be. And right now it's just flat dirt with a driveway apron.
Yeah.
They put the driveway apron in, you know, the curb. But yeah. There's nothing else there but a sign with
Is this a newer community that's being built?
Yes.
And so you're and now, did you design the house you're going to be in, or was it one of many plans that were made available to you?
Yeah, no, it's one of five or six different houses. They call them by different names, on varying sizes and varying, you know.
Layouts, yeah.
Yeah, varying layouts that you buy. Well, and once you choose the house, then you choose options. Like my house is going to be a four-bedroom house. I had the option of it being a three-bedroom house with a loft upstairs,
mm-hmm.
or making that a fourth bedroom. I'm going to have a home theater downstairs. I put in a media room where it's going to be completely enclosed. I'm going to put a projection screen TV in there and put some acoustical material in there. It's going to be a real theater.
Mm-hmm.
I got a morning room. That's the new thing now. They have these morning rooms that are off the kitchen.
That's where if somebody dies, you go in there and cry.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. You have to stay awake.
So it's, you know, and then how many bathrooms you want, whether you want half baths, whether you know, it's just a whole ton of things to pick and choose. And
now, why did you get out of the house you're in?
Reduce costs. I don't need to, because of the kind of work I do, I don't commute. I'm home unless I'm visiting clients.
Yeah.
And I live in Virginia, and I have to see clients in Virginia, Maryland, DC, and North Carolina.
So
I don't have to live in Loudoun County, Virginia, which is the richest county in the country.
Right.
And everything is more expensive here.
Mm-hmm.
I'm moving to I'm moving an hour away from here, away from D.C. by another, you know. Mm-hmm.
But what I'm saying is, why are you getting out of that house? Is it just more convenient being in this newer place?
Just be way less money.
What about
way less money than it costs me now? Yeah. Taxes are half.
Oh, okay. All right. Now that's making sense.
And the house, this is a townhouse. This is a townhouse, this is not a one-family home. This is an attached home, right, in a row. And I sold this for $450. The new house I'm buying is $395.
But you own like one part of the townhouse, right?
I own this particular structure. I own it. This is not a co-op or anything like that.
Oh, I see. But it's a townhouse style. It's not. There's not another.
Yeah, three level townhouse.
Do you know what they do here in New York? Here in Harlem, what they did here in Harlem, and it's kind of interesting. They built homes for low income people. But they built really nice ones, townhouses. And in each townhouse, you know about this, right, Jeff? They put a apartment in the bottom. So these people really never had to pay any money for their apartment. They just rented out these apartments on the bottom floor, and that paid for the cost of the, you know. So that was really wonderful. I wish I were that poor.
Yeah, yeah. Every other town. This is Loudoun County, and what they don't pay teachers well here.
Mm-hmm.
They don't pay people who work for the county very well.
Yeah,
and because of that, I live in a two-car garage townhouse. It's the width of a two-car garage.
Mm-hmm.
Every other one is a one-car garage, and those were only sold to county employees and people who earned under a specific dollar value.
Oh, okay.
And so to subsidize, it was subsidized by the county so that people who live, who are work in the hospitals and, you know, in the schools and the police, there's a lot of police who live here because they don't make very much money.
Yeah.
They can live in these car garage townhouses. So they subsidize a lot of housing around here.
So they're basically 20 feet wide, or?
Townhouse.
15, 18.
Yeah, I'll tell you what. My townhouse is, I think, 28 or 29 wide.
Mm-hmm.
So it's half of that.
Wow.
Wow.
Well, there's a house in Amsterdam that's really narrow. It's the narrowest house in the world. I think it's 10 feet wide.
Yeah. How long have you lived where you live, Jeff? I'm sure you own your house, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
But it is it's somewhat called a condo. Well, it's a completely independent house. Nobody else is attached or anything like that.
Yeah.
But the property, we own, I think, 10 feet all around the house.
Okay.
But the rest of the other house, they have 10 feet. But anything in between is somewhat community ownership. So it includes swimming pool and all kinds of other stuff. So that makes it a quote unquote condo. It's also where there's a golf course, which is attached to it.
Yeah.
So but you don't own the structure then if it's a condo, right?
I own the structure.
So how can it be a condo?
So it's a community.
I don't know, they call it a condo.
Okay. It's different from a co-op. A co-op, you don't own the structure. That's what it is.
When they built Southbury and Southbury, we put all the carpet in those were like a retirement community. Is that kind of like what you're in, Jeff?
Yeah, it's a 55 plus.
Yeah, community. And we my father's job. We put all the carpet in. It was 1 million yards of carpet. It was largest carpet job.
Before we go, I got to tell you a funny story. I don't know who complained or whatever. We now have a wheelchair ramp up our stairs downstairs. We're the only one of all the, there are like four buildings, they call them. We're the only one with a wheelchair ramp. And it's because one person moved in with a wheelchair. one person, and they had to do it.
Yeah. In my mother's condominium out on Long Island, they do the same thing. If you need like handicap, they don't have handicap parking, but if you need it, you can go to the board whomever, the condo board, and say, I need handicap parking. You show you have the permit, and then they'll put a handicap spot and they'll paint it. Mm. But that's the only way you can get that.
But they had to put up like a whole ramp. Okay, we don't have stairs in the front anymore. We have this ramp. It's an ugly-ass ramp, I might add.
But if you do any building or any modification, they make you become ADA compliant. Yeah. But what I'm thinking is, when you had the fire and you had that gas issue, maybe they forced them to become ADA compliant.
Yeah. Hey,
you got your gas back?
No.
No, not yet.
No, it's been it's been almost 4 months now, and they've been very quiet about it, you know. And then once it's on, then we have to maybe pay another $1,000 to have the dryer hooked up. I mean, it's insane. It's just insane. Anyway, thank you, everybody. I really appreciate it. Jeff, as always, wonderful. Phil, wonderful. Didn't get me too mad tonight. Anthony, Tony, terrific. I don't know if you said anything tonight, but, you know. Rob, thank you. Tim, thank you. Brian, always wonderful. Thank you. Also, who else was here? Steve was here. And was there anybody else who joined us tonight? No, that's pretty much it. I named them all. I don't want to leave anybody out. I just want to thank you all. Just wave goodbye to our audience so that they can see that you're happy campers. And I'll see you all again hopefully tomorrow. Same time, same station in life. In the meantime, stay tuned for Jack and Amy with The Intersection. That's following immediately on this same GabNet. They do a wonderful show. Just a wonderful show. In fact, you call them, will you? They like your calls, just like I like your calls. And I like your being part of all of this. Thank you so much for being with us this evening. And I'll see you again tomorrow. Same time, same station in life. In the meantime, if you see her, you know what to do. I'm getting away from my microphone so I couldn't hear. Tell her I love her, okay?